Everybody, and welcome to my channel. Today we're gonna talk about the underlying ideas that are gonna be introduced on all the Swift concurrency story. We're gonna be talking about structured concurrency. So let's get started. This is the third video on my series about Swift concurrency. On the first one, we talk about async await and some of the general APIs that are coming to Swift. And then we switch gears and focused on the actor system. What are actors and how they are gonna change the way we work. But there is one concept that I keep talking and mentioning on every video, and it's a very interesting and important topic to understand, and that's structured concurrency. So in this video, I want to spend some time telling you all about it. You have heard me say it. Swift concurrency, it's not based on premises, like in other languages. Async await is not just sugar on top of promises, it's quite the opposite. This is one of the key things to understand when you are going to start working with a Swift concurrency system. Sometimes we learn about new things like concurrency in this case or async await, and we just take the surface, you know, the surface explanation, which basically you're going to probably know that this is sugar for callbacks. But these things have a way bigger impact on you if you try to get an understanding of the underlying principles. I see conversations and suggestions on the still in progress proposals, which I think they come from a misconception and the fact that this is not sugar or these are not promises, this is a whole different thing. So I think and I recommend you that you forget about everything you know about asynchrony using promises or futures or other systems in other languages, and that you come with an open mind, because I think that if you understand structured concurrency and all the impact that it has and all the reasons that it has to exist, I think you'll understand much better how to work with Swift concurrency and all the proposals that are going around. So what is a structured concurrency anyway? As any good story, we first need to talk about what came before it. And that's structured programming. Nothing about asynchrony, just basically synchronous programming, but in a structured way. So let's talk about it. It's very likely that you have never heard about this concept, and that's just because nowadays it's very rare that we work in a program that it's not structured, so it's kind of the default and we all give it for granted. But I'm pretty sure you have heard before this sentence. Go to considered harmful. I'm sure you have heard this before. So well, let's explore what this means and what's the effect on the structure of a code and how it relates to the concurrency story. Usually, the basic program structure is just a sequence. It starts at the top, in this case on this first line, and it just keeps going down, advancing always downwards until it reaches the bottom and it exits. So that's it, that's very important. There is a start and there is an end. And everything that happens in between, it can happen a lot of things, but there is always a start at the top and then you go downwards until the end. Remember this, because that makes it very easy to reason about what's going on in a program. Let's compare this to what happens if we introduce this go-to. I'm saying introduce because right now no languages really have it in the same way that we used to have it in the beginning of the story, basically. But let's take a look at what happens. In contrast, if you start using go-tos, and go-tos just means I'm in this line, but now go to another random line. Like, you can specify anywhere in your program to jump to. So then you start at the top, and then you keep going down until, oh wait, there is a go-to here, so now let's go somewhere else. Where are we going? Well, yeah, you need to keep following the jumps of the go-to statement until you are lost, or the program, if you're lucky, it's kind of clear, but it's never clear. Go-to statement, that's why it's considered harmful, because your program, it doesn't start at the top and end at the bottom anymore. It starts doing weird things in the middle, and they are always hard to track. So adding a go-to into your program breaks the structure. It kind of deforms the structure of your program and it makes it way harder to understand. But this branching structure that the go-to can provide, it's still useful. And that's why we need more than just a sequence of operations. Thankfully, this is kind of like the basic abstraction that all the programming languages nowadays provide. And that's what we call control flow statements. So you can see here that instead of having go-tos that are all this unstructured thing that it's very hard to understand, we have more specialized tools like the selection, like a conditional, an if statement that goes from the top, it keeps going, it finds a question, and depending on the result of that predicate, it jumps to one place or another. But the important thing here is that no matter what happens, it always merges back and continues the program. That's the key thing. The same happens with an iteration, for loops, while loops, any kind of iteration that you want to consider. The important thing is that, yes, it can loop 1,000 times, a lot of times, but it doesn't matter because at the end it always merges and continues with the rest of the program. And the same happens with subroutines or function calls. You know that it doesn't matter what happens on that function, at the end of the day it's gonna return back to you and then your function can continue working with the next steps. So these are the examples of structured programming. And again, just to re-emphasize the idea, it's because the code starts at the beginning, we have control flow in the middle, things can happen, you can call many other functions, but at the end of the day, you know that it's always gonna come back to you, it's gonna merge at the end of the if statement, it's gonna get out of the while loop, and it's gonna continue working towards the next sequence of your program and reach the end. That means you don't have to follow all the traces and inspect all the code, follow all the function calls, because you know it's gonna return something and you can keep doing your code. The point here is that the constructs that we have now, they do the same thing as the go-to used to do, but in a controlled way. It's more structured, and that allows us to reason about the code, and it even opens new ways of coding. For example, let's take a look at the nice things that we get as a benefit of having this structure. Thanks to it, we have language features like defer, or error handling with try and catch, or other techniques with resource management. All that is because we have structured programming. They all work because the scopes and the stack of our program is clearly defined. Imagine what will happen if any of these features were kind of polluted by the go-to. Imagine what defer will do is if instead of exiting your scope, you could actually jump into another part of the program, or how error handling will work if you could jump randomly to any other part of the program without actually exiting and throwing the error. It will be a disaster. And that's why nowadays, realistically, nobody codes with go-tos. There are languages there that still have the go-to statement in there, but it's very limited. It's like, for example, in Swift, you can break into an existing labeled line, but that's very limited, and still you can never exit your function. So now that we understand what structured programming is, let's see how those benefits and those ideas can apply into the concurrency system. Let's talk about the many other forms of concurrency that are based on unstructured programming, and that's probably what you are mostly used to. If you take a look at this diagram, you can see what a promise is. You can see that it doesn't start at the top and ends at the bottom. There is actually a divergence in our code, which the divergence is good because we want concurrency, so we want these divergent lines. That's perfectly fine. But the problem that you can see here is that one of these divergences, it doesn't merge back into us. Like, it goes away and then we don't know what happens. You can compare it with the go-to that we drew before. It's exactly what happens. It's the same thing, it's just that instead of an asynchronous world, in a concurrent world. The thing happens with like any promise or feature library, even the go routines. The point here is that any of these systems call into this asynchronous functionality, but immediately return the control flow back to you. But the computation is still separate in a separate context, it can happen anywhere, and while the scope of your function ends, that computation is still somewhere. Maybe it has failed, maybe it has been passed into another 1,000 other functions. You don't know. There is no way to know until you follow all the traces. The same thing that we had with go-tos. It's true that these things, like promises, get rid of a lot of visual noise from callbacks, for example, but it doesn't make our code too much easier to understand and reason about, at least not until the point that we have normal synchronous code, that it's very easy to understand. You know, like, they help a little bit, but not by that much. When you start having complex systems, you actually see that it's hard to track where the promises go and all that stuff. So that's just because it's not structured. So now that we can see the parallel, let's see how structured concurrency is actually easier to understand. The idea is that the concurrency primitives are structured. They start, do what they need to do asynchronously without blocking, but they always come back to our scope. And most importantly, our function doesn't continue until those other operations have finished. You can compare here the structured asynchronous system with the subroutines with the normal function calls that we had before. Again, you can see that it's the same pattern, but now instead of just having one call to another function, you can have multiple because we have concurrency in the system. But they follow the same rules. So in other words, the programming scope, it's tied into the lifetime of the concurring work that we want to do. Our scope is not gonna end until all the operations have finished. So this makes structured concurrency look and feel very familiar. And that's just because it's based on the same principles of structured concurrency, which it's what we are used to. But not only that, it also brings all the benefits from it. So if you want to start a new work, you just call a function. In Swift, we have this await keyword to mark a suspension point, to tell the compiler that we want to wait for this asynchronous computation. But the important thing here is that that asynchronous computation can take a long time, it doesn't matter, we have all this concurrency functionality that it's very nice to have, but the important point is that it's gonna return back when it's done. You cannot proceed your work until that computation finishes. So that means that you can continue your work like you will normally do in a synchronous system, but with that concurrent computation. When you got the result, you can continue, and in this case, we're printing the answer from this computation into the console. Again, it's the same thing we already do, it's just that it's concurrent and not blocking, but it looks the same, it feels very familiar, and that's because the principles are the same. Of course, we also benefit from all the control flow statements that we already know and love. You can use ifs, you can use for loops, you can call other functions like we're doing here. Everything is still the same. Even those defers and those guards that we're used to in Swift, all of that works the same way with structured concurrency. So in the same way that a normal and synchronous code forms a kind of hierarchy, we can say that the same happens with structured concurrency. And this hierarchy of functions calling other functions and coming back, all this hierarchy, it's natural. It arises from just the structure of our code. That means that the information can flow up and down, and we don't have to write any specific code to do that at every level. That's very important because it means our program is a very well-defined hierarchy. Even if the work is asynchronous, the structure is still stable, like in normal synchronous programming. And a nice thing about this is that the system can pass contextual information down the hierarchy automatically. Like you can pass priorities down and even other custom values. I think this is proposed on the task locals Swift Evolution proposal, so if you're more interested in how to pass these custom values down the hierarchy, you can take a look at that. I think it's time to define how this work happens. What are these things that do this concurrent work? Well, in Swift, these things are called tasks. Tasks are the fundamental unit of concurrency. All the asynchronous functions run as part of a task. You can think of it like the threads, but they are more high level and they have other benefits. With structured concurrency, it means that when you're calling another function, you can create child tasks. So this hierarchy and this relationship is still maintained. But one important thing here is that we keep saying that the execution waits for the children. So let's explore what are the implications of that. If we're saying the function always awaits the children, what happens with cancellation? Well, in Swift, cancellation is asynchronous, and by that, it means that it's not immediate. But most importantly, it's cooperative, which means the functions need to explicitly check for the cancellation state. And in that case, if something is canceled, it's up to them to avoid doing more necessary work. Like you can see here, we have a task API with a boolean that it tells us if the task is canceled. In that case, we should early return from the function and avoid doing extra more computations. The important thing to understand here is that cancellation always propagates down, never up, and that the parent task, it still awaits for all the children tasks to finish. Cancellation is just setting this flag, and then hopefully all the children tasks are gonna check for it and early sooner than they will end without the cancellation check. So what happens with error handling? Well, error handling kind of works in the other way. Error handling is propagated up. To be honest, in the same way we're used to when working with synchronous programming. You throw from your function and then whoever called you is gonna handle that error. Or just keep throwing it up the call stack until somebody does something with it. So errors bubble up. And then the parent task, it needs to handle the error. What it can do is, for example, handle the error and say, well, I don't know what to do with error, so I'm gonna keep propagating it. If the propagation keeps going, all the children of that parent task, so the siblings of the one that throw the error, are automatically canceled. And of course, that doesn't mean the siblings disappear automatically. That's up to them to check for cancellation, and as we said, try to avoid to do more work. So as you can see, the flow of information is very natural. If something errors, the error goes up, and then the parent can manage it and keep going up, or say, okay, let me cancel all my children, and then when all of them have finished, hopefully sooner, then I can finish myself. So as you can see, it's a very natural way of working with errors, working with cancellations, and that's because that's basically what we're used to it already. So again, it follows the same principles that we are very familiar with. I keep saying, again, that the computation cannot proceed until the function that you call returns. In this case, for example, you can see that we are awaiting on the compute of 4 and awaiting on the compute of 2. So what I mean by that is that the second line, it's not going to happen until the computation of the first line finishes. That's very nice, and that keeps the structure of our system, but of course, it wouldn't be very useful if we couldn't really do things in parallel. The thing here is that the fact that we want to do things concurrently and in parallel doesn't mean we need to opt out of the structured concurrency. It doesn't mean that we need to start thinking about promises and all that stuff. It doesn't mean that at all. What you need to understand is that the async await, it's kind of like automatically creating a children task for you, executing it and just waiting for it to complete, and then it goes into the next one. But there is no reason for that to not happen manually. And that's why we have a way of creating dynamically child tasks. That's done with the task group. A task group defines a scope to spawn dynamically, so it means programmatically, with a function call, child tasks. In here, you can see how we have this with task group API that starts the scope. You see that it starts at the freeze line and it adds almost at the end. Inside this scope, you have access to the group. And this group provides this API that you can use to start spawning child tasks. It's important to understand that this group doesn't expose any future-like system. You should never get this group and do something with it that makes it escape the scope where it's created, because that defeats the whole point of a structured concurrency. In theory, the language shouldn't allow us to do that, but I'm not sure yet if that's already possible in Swift or if it's up to the programmer. Now, the important thing here is that we're spawning child tasks, but we are not waiting for it in any way. There is no await on the scope of the group. Well, that just means that the group is gonna wait automatically at the end of the scope. Again, the scope is not gonna finish until all the children are completed. But of course, we can wait ourselves, and actually you need to wait if you need to return something, because otherwise there is nothing that you can return from the group. So we have this API where on the group you can call next. And next is gonna await, it's an asynchronous function, so it's gonna wait to get a result from any of the children. The order is not determined. So when you get a result from the children, the next is gonna give you that result. You can put that in a while loop, and when all the children have returned something, then the next function is gonna return nil. So you know that all your children are completed and you can proceed with whatever you want to do. Again, if you don't do that, automatically the group is gonna do it at the end of the scope. But wait, if you have worked with Swift before, you may find this next call very familiar. And that's because it's the same API that you have on a sequence. And that's because a group is actually an async sequence. It's a new type of sequence that works with asynchronicity. That means that everything you can do with a sequence, you can do it with an async sequence, just with an await. So in this case, instead of doing a while loop that we are not really used to do that, we prefer to do for ins. That's perfectly fine because you can do a for in of the group because it's an async sequence and the code is the same. But not only that, all the fancy functional APIs that we are used to on Swift sequences, you can also have them on the async sequence. So for example, all this piece of code that if you were working synchronously you will never write because that's a reduce. Like you can see it from here, it's a clear reduce operation. In the synchronous world, you can also have it because you just need to put an await and the group is in a synchronous sequence, so you can reduce and look how nice this code it is. But let's be honest, it's not very nice if you need to do this every time that you need some concurrent system. So if you want to do two things at the same time, you don't have to wait for one and then the other because they don't depend on each other, and you want to do things concurrently in parallel, it will be kind of a pita if you actually had to do this all the time. But that's why Swift provides this nice, like super nice, this is what I love the most, to be honest, because I've already talked about it on the first video actually about Swift concurrency. But you can just, instead of doing a let await, you can do an async let. And now what this is basically doing is, this is literally sugar for the code we have just seen. This is actually creating a task group and spawning children for you, but they will run concurrently in parallel. And then when you want to use them, you actually need to await at the usage side. And that's what's going to wait for the results and collect all the results, and then you can do whatever you want. So look at this, like we have structured concurrency, you can run things in parallel, and it feels like what you're familiar to. Like if you ignore the async and await from this code, it's literally the same thing that you will write if you were writing in the synchronous program. It's just that all of this is asynchronous, concurrent, and even parallel. But still, I know what you're thinking. What if I still want to do a computation that I don't depend on? Fair enough, sometimes you really want to start the work on a background and you don't care about the output at all. So there are always escape hatches. In this case, we have this detach function that actually creates a new task that has no relationship whatsoever with the current execution context. And that's basically do this computation or not at some point, like we don't know. So the thing here is that returns a handle, which yes, you can think of it as a kind of like a promise. But if you're doing this, consider that you are losing all the nice things about the structured concurrency. If you're doing this, you have this handle that you can pass to these functions, and who knows what's happening in there, you don't know, you have no clue. And then somewhere down the line, somebody needs to actually take this handle and await on it. So to await on it, you have this API to call get, and that basically waits for the computation to finish and returns the result to you. But really, let's try to avoid doing this. Like it will be very easy that when we start working with some concurrency, we bring our ideas of unstructured concurrency, of promises and all that stuff. We can bring all those ideas and then we're not gonna learn anything. We're not gonna benefit of all this nice system, and that would be a shame. So let's try to put this on a drawer. Let's avoid doing this for now, and let's just enjoy the structured concurrency system. And that's it for today. Thank you for watching. I hope you learn what structured concurrency is and actually that you understand the benefits of it. I think that's the most important part. And as you can see, it feels very familiar what you're used to. It's just that now magically everything can run asynchronously, but we can use the tools and the systems that we are so used to. So I hope this has clarified a little bit more what's coming to Swift with the concurrency story. And if you learned something today, please like the video, share it with your friends so they also can learn, and subscribe if you want to see more content like this. Thank you all for watching, and see you next time.